flies by when I'm feeling low, but that isn't all I know. Days go slow, but the weeks go fast, and eventually it's all in the past. Time flies by when I'm feeling low, but that isn't all I know. Days go slow and the nights go slower, but look to the future and soon you'll know. Hi guys, welcome to the first panel of Enicon for the last day. I hope you guys had a great 3 days and we're excited to kick it off with our first panel, how indie labels are disrupting the music industry. Well, we have two of my favorite labels on this panel. We have Mom and Pop, who is home to artists such as Flume, Courtney Barnett, Jiluf, and our very own Berkeley alumni, Ash. Michael Goldstone is here to talk about Mom and Pop, and we also have Disruption, which is my other favorite label, with Laure as our label manager and Lamberto as our head of biz dev. So I'm also on the Disruption label. We actually help our Berkeley students foster and make an artist career outside of Berkeley. So this is how indie labels kind of start out. So I'm excited to kind of kick off this call and talk about how artists in our audience can also break their careers and how indie music labels really have been making such a big difference right now. So before we really start, I would love to ask you guys, how did you get into the music industry and what led you to where you are? Goldie, if you want to kick it off.
Yes, when I lived in Los Angeles and was in high school, there was not the music programs that exist today, and I was going to school at night and also had a job after school, Stone High School, at a record company called Chrysalis, which was a very small independent label at the time and had a number of artists. But for me, I had gotten to a point where I had to make a choice between trying to go to school full time and having a job that I would be looking for had I graduated. And so for me, I made the tough decision to jump straight into work. So I'm not the greatest speaker to be able to speak to what you guys have been able to kind of, go through in terms of your experience, but I certainly wish that I would have had that opportunity, but I started before that. Do you want me to keep going? Cause I can ramble. But I thought that somebody else should.
Yeah. Laure, why don't you go next?
Yeah. So for me, I've been in the music industry since I was little. I was playing concert and stuff, and I didn't really know about the music business side until my first year of undergrad, where I was at a business school and I was looking for internships. And I was like, oh, why not trying to, find something in the music industry? And that's when I started, I found an internship at Universal, and then I decided I didn't want to do anything else than working in the music industry.
Excellent.
Right. Guess I'm next. So hello, I'm Lamberto Sanchez. I'm from Castellón, a small town nearby Valencia. So I'm a local here in Berkeley. I started in music when I was 13 years old, playing in local punk rock and metal bands in my city. And that took me actively touring for a few years. Also worked as a booking agent and a promoter. So I started my first years more in the live side of the business. And past that, I spent a couple of years managing a mixing engineer as well. And that led me into 2020. Started my master's degree here at Berkeley, where I had the opportunity to join Disruption Records. And my main project this year has been setting up the first ever publishing division in Disruption Records. And yeah, that's basically a big summary of what I've done, and really excited to be here today.
Excellent, excellent. We're a bunch of music lovers here. That's good to know. So just to kick off with our first official question, I didn't know if everyone knew this, but independent labels own about 30% of the market share in the music industry. And right now they're really making a splash, especially with the digital era. So right now, what would you say is the most important thing about finding the right fit with the label? What factors really come into play for why an artist would choose an indie label over a major or even staying independent? Michael, would you want to go first for that one?
Sure. I think there's a certain kind of artistry that a mentality that usually puts indie artists and indie labels together. It's somewhat philosophical. A lot of the bigger companies represent different paths to success. And I think indie-minded people and, you know, people that really want to maintain their sort of levels of control and their levels of, you know, being left alone artistically have a tendency to sometimes drift to independent labels where, you know, that process is a little bit more holistic and seamless. And, you know, you're really looking for a fit. There's certain artists that really would be a good fit for an independent label like ours. And there's certain artists and managers with expectations and approach that might not be. So, you know, a lot of it's in the DNA of the artist and the manager in terms of what kind of journey they're looking to go on.
Laura, would you like to also give your take as representing disruption?
Yeah, for sure. I totally agree with what Michael said from what I've seen so far. I think one thing that is really important is that definitely like being agreeing with the artist and their manager on where they want to go and seeing if the label can take them there. That's something we've seen in disruption. You know, like we don't work with artists that are already developed because we couldn't provide them, you know, like what they would need. So that's definitely important. And I think something that is also very important is trust, making sure that, you know, like you understand each other, but that also that you trust each other and that you're going to be able, you know, like to trust for the artist your music to the label, but for the label, you know, like also trusting the artist to actually, you know, like do the things on their side and being involved in the process.
I definitely agree. And so the thing that really makes indie labels really stand out is not just kind of like how they're curating these genres and niche markets, but also like how important are label services to indie labels and what services really distinguish the label? Lamberto, would you like to answer that first?
Yeah, sure. Nowadays we are in a really evolving environment in terms of the music business, of course. New sources of revenue appear every day, and labels being the middle point, the intersection between the fans and the artists have to be always really updated have to be in the crest of the wave in terms of like what kind of services they can provide for these artists to connect with the fan bases, right? So in terms of what happened with disruption this year, it's been a really important year for us because apart from the advantages we have through our partnerships with the Orchard in terms of distribution, a key turning point for us this year in terms of services was setting up the label's first ever publishing division, because taking into consideration that all of our artists in our roster are some writers as well, it was a natural move, right, to make this in order to serve them in a more holistic way, right? So now we are offering publishing administration services through a partnership we secure with SunTrust, as well as creative services, which the label started to deliver last year with our Syndec department. So today we can probably say that we are helping our artists, not just as artists, but also as songwriters. And my hope is that potentially in the future, in the near future, the songwriting ecosystem will encourage artists in a roster to collaborate, write and produce together more often, since as we know, like this new context of you know, putting out singles so fast, it's in need of bringing the artists ecosystems where they can create in a more fast manner, right? So yeah, this has been a year of reevaluating this and thinking about how to provide our artists as lab writers with new services to help them out making their art and also approaching their fans.
Definitely agree. It sounds like Disruption is kind of like knows their artists pretty well and kind of figured out a service that it's really tailored to them. That's really interesting. What would you say from mom and pop's perspective, what label services are very important for the label and how does that distinguish mom and pop from other indie labels or even majors?
I think that we've structured ourselves over time, you know, as with a services mentality. A lot of artists that have the choices to go to all, you know, to self-release, to release through a major, through an indie, through an aggregator. And I think we've always felt that in order to be a record company in 2021, it was really important to be able to provide for your artists, because a lot of times people say, what does a label really do? And, you know, we really are covering the arc of what we think it takes to develop a recording artist, in the sense of, you know, the right digital people in terms of pitching and, you know, hiring out PR, our international coordination, because we're a global company. All the marketing managers who sort of coordinate with management and artists in terms of the creative and making sure that everything, you know, looks the way it should and sounds the way it should. And, you know, you really, as a label, you really want to, first and foremost, you know, have that experience be an art, something that an artist looks back on and says, that was the experience that I was looking for. I had support. People put my music out there. It sounded the way I wanted, and I was left alone to sort of go make my musical statement. And, you know, we really need to, as a label, do all the things that help elevate their career, so that the other aspects of their career, such as touring and writing, can be robust. So services, you know, and what you're able to do for an artist and a manager is essential. And for us, it's a little bit different each time.
No, I agree. I think the real heart of that message is like knowing how to listen to your artists and what they really want and kind of taking those considerations in and making the most of it. I think that's really interesting, and that's a really good way to really understand your artist as well. So we know us at Disruption, we're kind of working with all these Berkeley artists, and they're at all at different levels, from starting off just realizing their craft to also already making music and understanding it. And, you know, and we also have a very global roster, but I think for us, we would love to know how, you know, for mom and pop standpoint, what is the role of indie labels in curating the music scene, and how can we help our own artists find their place in these music scenes?
When you say scene, I'm not sure what you do mean in terms of environment and music, just the landscape.
Yeah, like the landscape of music, like finding their genre, just finding their place, whether they're trying for a commercial sound or even indie sound, or, you know, from a global standpoint, it's also about territory as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question. I don't know if Murato or somebody else wants to jump in, but you know, from our standpoint, you know, we're in a musical time that is much more genreless in a really great way than it's ever been. And I think that, you know, with the way that artists are developing their audiences, it's super frequent that there's real clarity on where their audience is and where their audience is growing and where it's building. And a lot of times it really gets defined, you know, by that artist and manager. And at that point, once you sort of have a sense of where an artist can really thrive, is to do the things within that space. Some artists might be more, you know, touring focused. Some artists might be more bedroom focused. You know, it really depends on, you know, where that artist's response is coming from and being able to grow it.
That's great. So with all of that, like, what really distinguishes the artist development process at an indie versus major? I mean, Laure, you've worked at Universal, and yeah, now you're heading an indie label. And what is your perspective in these two different processes?
Yeah, I think it's very different. But the stage of where, you know, like, where the label comes in the artist life for me is like the biggest difference, because majors don't necessarily sign, you know, like, emerging ads anymore. They, you know, like, sign them once they already have like a social fan base and, you know, like, a certain amount of listeners. And when you're an indie, at least at Description, that's the model we chose, you know, like, signing them from the very beginning and helping them building, you know, like, their artist identity, advising them on everything. There is also like a huge, you know, like, educational purpose, making sure that they develop themselves as artists, but also as music industry professionals, you know, like, understanding how it works and why we do this, so that they can, you know, like, later just do it by themselves, or at least, you know, give their opinion when they're going to be working with another team at another label. And basically, you know, like, then all of the rest is a little bit similar, working on the music, A&R, promotion, marketing. The other, like, big difference, I would say, is the budget. We focus more on, you know, like, the very beginning of what we could do with them when it doesn't necessarily require, you know, like, a huge budget. And then we are more than happy to transfer it to, you know, like, other labels once they need a little bit more of a financial support.
Yeah, that's very true. That's really a different standpoint. For Goldie, you know, you kind of helped put together Pearl Jam and Rage Against the Machine, all these big artists, and now you're working at Mom and Pop. You know, what is the difference between, you know, discovering those acts and working with so many big artists at bigger labels versus now when with Mom and Pop and doing the artist development process for a wide range of genres now?
In terms of the difference between the two?
Yes.
Well, I mean, it's, you know, for myself, it's a paramount and transformative difference, because, you know, I had spent, as you alluded to, many years working in major labels, and the relationship with A&R and within a major label is somewhat limited, in the sense that you don't really have the ability to automatically engage the rest of the company. And part of what your job is at a major is to sort of politic your way through to be able to get the artists that you work with the visibility and attention that they deserve. So a lot of more puts you in a position of advocacy when you start, you know, you're an indie label, you're in a situation where, you know, the purity of the decision is left alone, because it's really about label and artist and manager, and there isn't business affairs, and there aren't heads of A&R, and there aren't people that you need to sort of run and vet through. If you make a decision as an indie, and I'm sure the Laure and Lamberto can confirm this, you know, you just go and you start working. And a lot, you know, the biggest difference is that you spend more of your time trying to help your artists externally as a smaller label in terms of moving them along. And sometimes as a bigger label, it's about trying to get everybody on the same page, because it's such a big and powerful machine. So it's just they move in different paces. And as, you know, Laure was alluding to earlier, you know, when you're jumping with an artist that's at a very developmental place, you know, and in most instances, you're not even able to spend, because there isn't enough audience to really be able to spend. So you build until you're able to generate. But the biggest difference is the levels of control and the collaboration with artists. And another thing that probably should be said is, you know, the approach to the deals themselves. You know, deals at indies, you know, certainly are indie, and I can't speak for Disruption, but it's a very equitable split of profits. And, you know, we're in mostly situations that are 50-50, which puts artists and managers and label in a position to say, okay, it's all of our money. So let's figure out how we want to spend it as opposed to the label's money. You know, we go in every relationship assuming and hoping and expecting every artist to you know, to find their way and to, you know, create their own economics. So we like it to be in a place where, you know, that first dollar is, you know, split up a profit.
Yeah, I'm glad you, Lamberto, did you want to speak about, make a point too?
I wanted to make a point, you know, like right now we are talking about the difference between the mayors and the INOs in terms of how they approach their businesses. And one of the things I wanted to highlight also is that if we compare an indie, you know, versus a major, majors are trying to, you know, work in way different genres, and it's for them it's more difficult to be updated with what's going on in a cultural level, right? That's how, you know, many music genres and still lots of bands are founding their messages and their artistic. In their artistic perspective is based on a cultural movement, right? And indie labels are more into that new waves, into that new ways of, you know, expressing art. And I think that's one of the interesting aspects of indies is that they grow from a cultural scope and specific movement. And at the time to develop the artistic proposal with the artist is, I think they're both are more in like in the same perspective, right? And I think it's one of the advantages in this have that majors normally struggle more with, right?
Definitely agree. If anyone else wanted to kind of comment as well, but that's actually a great perspective. It's for indies, it's more about the long-term game. How can we make this artist last as long as possible in the market? And, you know, what are their long-term plans versus, you know, making a moment? That might be a little bit different for majors as well. But the one thing that we did touch upon is kind of the money perspective. I know you know, Goldie and Laure brought that up. And I think our audience is also very curious about, especially about where are indie labels getting the funds and how do they know, like, based on how much to spend on one artist versus another when they're developing them? So, you know, floor is open. If anyone wants to take that question about budgets and profit and loss statements.
That's a fun one, right?
Yeah.
Wanna go, Laure?
For us, it's going to be very short because our budget comes mostly from Berkeley subventions, and we, you know, like, really try to find sponsorships with, you know, like brands and partnerships, and we also try to get, you know, like everything we can for free and really work on the organic side because obviously we are very limited in terms of budget. In terms of, you know, like how we split that among artists, we always try to, you know, like keep a certain equity depending on, you know, like the number of the songs and stuff, because when we sign an artist, we take an engagement to them to, you know, like help develop them. Then after, of course, there is also the appreciation of the music and how we think it's going to work. And if we feel we need to push an artist more than another, because, you know, like the music is starting to get big and we need to push a little bit of promotion, that's definitely, you know, like something we do.
That's really interesting. Goldie, I don't know, from mom and pop side, how different is it for you guys?
Well, I think, you know, look, we essentially started with a long point with myself and somebody from NYU and, you know, weren't as evolved as a disruption in terms of having a path. And so for us, you know, we had to be equally scrappy then when, you know, in finding opportunities for artists until we could sort of, you know, grow a culture. You know, we're in a position now where we're trying to be commensurate with trying to spend in a way that puts artists and managers in a position to keep going and to be somewhat sort of thoughtful in how and where we spend that money, because in theory you're really spending, you know, every dollar that we spend now is a dollar that's, you know, that Ash, you know, it's half her money and half our money. So, you know, a lot of times you're spending resources as artists start to develop and get bigger and those opportunities open up, and the, what, you know, company like Disruption and, you know, and companies like that and ours can do is, you know, to be there during that sort of developmental process, and support in ways that aren't necessarily financially based or require spend. And those are the things that start to, you know, further artists along in terms of, you know, the relationships that we all have and the passion that we all have to further these artists.
It sounds great. Yeah, I agree too, definitely. I know you just mentioned Ash. I think we're all a bit curious because she's a Berkeley alumni. You know, she's doing great. She had huge success with her song "Moral of the Story." Now her debut album just came out and is doing great. I think we would love to like hear kind of the story behind her a little bit more. You know, as Berkeley alumni, we're all trying to find our success story as well. So, I mean, Goldie, would you like to talk a little bit more about Ash? And, you know, she's doing great right now. We all love her music.
It's very exciting, and especially because of the journey that she's gone through, which obviously started at Berkeley and continued in Nashville as a songwriter and led her to Los Angeles for more songwriting. And I think from that, she built a culture around her with a number of artists in Los Angeles in terms of the writing community, whether it be Wee Thin or Lewis the Child, or you know, the relationship she's built with Phineas and a lot of the artists and writers and producers. But I think what was interesting about Ash's path that people don't really pay attention to or understand or know is that this is somebody that you know, that jumped on the back of a tour bus, got in a van, you know, walked, ran, trained, you know, did everything humanly possible to do 6 or 7 tours as an opening artist in really, you know, kind of shitty conditions, and looked at every single opportunity as an opportunity to build and gain fans. And before Moral of the Story happened, Ash was building a really authentic and genuine audience, albeit obviously much smaller than it is now. But all those steps and all those shows and all those responses to those, you know, to those IGs and all those speaking to the audience that Ash has done is, you know, has become a, in some ways, symbolic for a lot of the other artists on the label to look at, because it's not as simple as, you know, go to Berkeley, write great songs, you know, go to get signed to a label and, you know, you're and blow up. Just, you know, and I think it's really great to know that Ash was building a career without that moment, because when those moments come along, like, you know, to All the Boys I've Loved Part 2, and that song becomes part of pop culture, you know, it only sort of enhanced something that was already real and authentic underneath it, and gave her and us the opportunity to amplify her music.
No, that's really cool. And I didn't know like how much, you know, work she was doing on her own. That like, I think that's something that, you know, Berkeley students also need to understand is, hey, you get the degree and you do, you know, you're great at songwriting, you're good at vocal, but you know, what are you doing outside of that to really find those opportunities and really like shine as well outside of, you know, graduating now. So, you know, you talked about some of the strategies you had with these artists as well, but we would love to kind of dive into the distribution and promotional strategies that indie labels have. So Laure, would you kind of want to talk about kind of how Disruption has more unique strategies to kind of work with distribution and promotion for a global roster, really?
Yeah, sure. So I think the first thing is in the choice of distributors we decided to work with The Orchard and with Taihee Music Group, So it gives us, you know, really like the opportunity to have two continents and, you know, like having marketing strategies that are specialized for Asia and the rest of the world with the orchard. And I guess in terms of promotion, you know, like we really focus on everything that is building a very, very strong artist identity and using all the promotional tools we can get that can be like live or participating in INOCON, like our artist did yesterday, or even, you know, we try to get coverage and we use platforms such as Submit Hub to submit the music and trying to find sync opportunities and partnerships. So it's very broad because we have the advantage of, you know, like very starting from the ground, we can, you know, like allow ourselves to try a little bit of everything and kind of see what works and trying to adapt on each artist based on each artist and what works for them or not.
Definitely. I think it's more about localizing and making sure you understand these markets as well and where these artists are really from and how do you kind of build them out in here. I know for Mom and Pop, the roster is also pretty global. You know, Courtney Barnett, Bloom are from Australia, Dry Wolf has Bengali roots as well. So, you know, what kind of strategies do you play at Mom and Pop for distribution and promotion for these types of artists? They have a presence in the US, but what about for their, you know, strategy in other markets as well?
When we first started, we really focused on North America. It was a different moment in time. The world wasn't quite as global as it is now. It was sort of that moment where your Pitchfork announce or your Fader premiere, everything was reaching people in a global moment. And over time, we've, become a global company. We strive to sign artists globally and worldwide for a number of reasons. What we've done rather than going into a system is approached each territory individually. We have somebody in the UK that really sort of air traffics controls how we sort of move through the system and self-release. So we release globally, and then we hire locally, in theory, you know, a lot of the same people, whether it be pluggers, whether it be PR, whether it be anything that can kind of further those artists. Rather than going through a label, we've figured out a way to hire and build those teams without going through another label to do it, or you know, a system like the Orchard, you know, which I should say, you know, Mom and Pop went through Red Orchard, you know, Red became the Orchard. Mom and Pop was probably there for at least 10 of the first 13 years, and we could not have really built our label without the support that we got all across the world, and especially locally from the Red people. And especially when you're, you know, a smaller, you know, younger company, it's really, you know, they do become an extension of your label. And along the way, there's been an incredible amount of talented people who, you know, within that distribution and services space have thrived and moved artists along. So those systems are really valuable as well.
Yeah, I agree. And it sounds like you made very important relationships as well to help you kind of figure out how to get into these markets and find the right people as well. That's really interesting way to kind of take in promotional strategies and distribution strategies. So it sounds like you kind of been able to build Mom and Pop up to where they are now. How important is it for an indie label to create a brand of their own, and what elements really help create this brand?
Well, you know, the branding thing is can be tricky, and it depends somewhat philosophically on your approach. I was encouraged a long time ago to not tell people what I was going to do, but to go actually do it and have them see it for themselves. And I think when you're first starting an indie label, whether it's Disruption or Mom and Pop or any of these labels, you know, your identity in some ways is tied to your artists, and in some ways you really want to be able, without saying we're this or we're that, to define your aesthetic with, you know, with the artists and the diversification of how you sort of build your roster that defines your DNA and your personality. And for us, you know, we kept our head down for a long time, and, you know, until other people started to say, hey, you guys seem to have, you know, an approach and a brand and aesthetic. And I think for us, you know, we started to recognize that rather than being a genre-based label, in some ways we were striving for what was said earlier, I think, by Lamberto in terms of, you know, culture or some, you know, and I think we found that a lot of our bands were playing, despite being musically way different, we're playing a lot of the same festivals, and that sort of brought a cohesiveness to what we were doing. But, you know, it's not something that, if you're too conscious and you try too hard to brand your label before furthering your artists, it can be tricky, because you really want those artists to be ambassadors in some ways, and speak for you by the work that you do. So, regardless of what I might have done at a major, by the time I got to an indie, people said, yeah, that's great, but, you know, what is mom and pop? And, you know, all these questions that are in this chat bar over here are all great questions. I hope we can get to some of them.
Yeah. Lamberto and Laure, do you want to talk about kind of the branding? Like, what is the vision with Disruption and the branding? I know, you know, Disruption is very in a unique state where it grows with the roster it has. So what is kind of the way they keep up the branding with each new roster?
Mm-hmm. Lamberto, do you want to go?
Yeah, I can add something on that. I completely agree with Michael. I think that, at least for Disruption, that we change our roster every year. Our brand is normally based on what the artists want to bring to the table and how they are, you know, approaching their own artistic proposal. And at the end of the day, I believe that in any indie label, the DNA of the own label is based on who the artists are and how they want to express their art. And yeah, that's my opinion. And I think that Disruption has this like consistent, you know, purpose. But one of the most interesting things is that I think it shapes along the years because of this, right? And I think it's a beautiful thing.
Disruption,
yeah, definitely.
Is a great name, by the way. I just thought I'd
Thank you.
Names are important, you know, and that's sometimes where the branding really becomes its first impression. And Disruption is a really excellent name for what you do.
Yeah, I think go ahead. Yeah, I think it just like brings directly what we are trying to do, you know, like with the way we work with the artists, but also with, you know, like the missions and the values we are trying to associate ourselves with. We didn't come up with the name, we, you know, I got the label with it, but that was for sure something we didn't want to change, because it just reflects everything we're trying to, you know, like put out there.
Yeah, I also agree with that. I know we only have a couple of minutes left. We have a lot of questions about money. Someone's curious about the types of record deals at Disruption. I will say it's very traditional, 50-50. So that I will answer that question myself, because there's one question that's really interesting that we'd love to get an answer for. So what if one of your artists breaks in and gets proposals from majors to sign a record deal? Would you let him or her go? You know, that's a fun question. It's a very if-then question.
Well, do you want to answer that one first, or do you want Lamberto or me to? I mean, it's
you can go, Michael. I would be interested in knowing your point of view.
Well, it's a good question, and in some ways maybe you know, a question of historically, you know, indies and majors and indies being sort of perceived as not being able to do similar, similar things. A lot of the questions that we had gotten when we were a young company was, you know, can you do this? Can you do that? Can you get an artist on SNL? Can you can you get a Grammy nomination? Can you get an artist on the radio? You know, a lot of things which, you know, the majors sort of speak to in terms of we can make you the next, you know, Billie Eilish. And I think, you know, indie contracts by their nature are historically shorter than major label contracts. So it's more likely for an artist to sort of not want to continue as opposed to leave in the middle of a record. And, you know, if the only, you know, you never want to really stop an artist, but you also don't want to be in a situation where the only, you know, where the reasoning in wanting to change labels isn't timely or isn't, you know, or isn't equitable. You know, it's a tricky one, and they're all a little bit different. You don't want to hold up people from working where they want to, but you also don't want to do the work as a label like ours and spend that money and those resources and develop and break an artist, and then have somebody else say, I want to go buy that consumption because I'm a major label. I'm going to go buy that income stream that Disruption is built and Mom and Pop is built or Merge is built or Sub Pop or whoever it might be. And it's very predatory in a weird way. So, you know, I think that every situation is a little bit different. And I think that you have to be sort of thoughtful. I mean, there are artists that didn't want to continue, and we've said, you know, it's not the right thing and you should do this somewhere else. But I think it's a little more challenging for majors to come in and, you know, when other labels have those rights and buy those rights out, because they're too valuable. They have to a lot of times buy futures. But there's a lot, you know, going on more competitively with economics before those artists get signed in some ways. Meaning if there's a TikTok phenomenon, you know, a lot of people are going to try to sign it based off that consumption. But what we're not trying to do is to be, you know, the minor leagues to build up artists, you know, for bigger labels to sort of run with. It's not really what our mission is. And, you know, we believe, you know, with what we've been able to do that aspirationally, and now having, you know, done this for 13 years, that we can spend just like everybody else if the opportunity is there. So we're reticent to just in theory, you know, have people just sort of say, yeah, thanks, it's been great. But we also don't, you know, we're not looking to keep people who don't really want to be here. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. And it's a great way to wrap up this panel, really. We're a couple of minutes over, but really that was like the best way to end this and kind of really give us what is it? Just kind of like a wrap up of how indie labels are really disrupting the music industry. So I really appreciate your time kind of telling us about indie labels and how we've been.
No, I was just going to say, I'm sure that I speak for all of us.